Do you know anyone who is directly dealing with the trans issue? Maybe you know someone whose daughter thinks she's a boy. Maybe your nephew is slightly built, not athletic, and thinking maybe he's really a girl. Maybe you have responsibility for a religious education class, and most of your students have trans friends and think that trans is just fine. Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute, an international interfaith coalition to defend the family and build a civilization of love. You've really got to watch this interview with therapist Pamela Garfield-Jaeger. She has written, in my opinion, the best, most practical guide for parents, grandparents, teachers, and pastors who are trying to navigate the trans maze, with very specific instructions about what to do and not do about some of the important problems that you're going to be facing in your lives. I know you're going to be fascinated by this conversation. You're going to want to come back to it again and again, and you're going to want to share this with your family and friends.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, when you know someone is suicidal and is at risk of suicide, unless they're really at risk, and this is even if they are at risk, you don't talk about suicide all the time. The fact that this is being mentioned all the time and it's all over social media, this, you know, suicide prevention, that's wrong. We're creating a problem here. If you're saying in front of a child, this is astounding to me that a therapist will tell this parent that line that you just said, would you rather have a dead daughter or a living son, in front of the teenage child in the session together. I mean, how is that looked at as giving them the idea and giving them an out, giving them this ultimatum? It is blackmail. It's reinforcing what someone would look at as personality disorder traits. So things that we as therapists always were trained to help people not do, to learn how to ask for help in a healthy way.
Yes. So tell people a little bit about some of the vulnerabilities that you see among the young people who do get swayed by this stuff.
Yeah. So how I view the whole trans thing is what it is it's preying on the vulnerable. So there is some kind of vulnerability, and the trans activists and the trans community, they kind of prey on that. So one of the biggest vulnerabilities is people who are autistic.
Pamela Garfield-Jaeger, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Thank you. I'm so glad to be here. Again, yes, the second time.
Again, exactly. Yeah. You are a returning guest. You are the truthful therapist. And we talked with you about a number of issues about a year ago, I would say, if my records are right. But now you've got a new book. And honestly, Pam, I'm really excited about your new book because the trans issue, as you know, is out of control. You know, it's a really it's a big and powerful social and cultural legal juggernaut. And there are a lot of people working on it. But most of the people working on it are working on it from, you know, either a medical perspective or a legal perspective or philosophical or, you know, history. Where did all this stuff come from? What I like about what you've got is the most practical, down-to-earth thing for somebody who's in the midst of it, who's right there in the throes of it. So before we get to the substance of your book, you told a little story in the beginning of the book that I think is really interesting that I want you to share, which is what you call your Rip Van Winkle story. You were like asleep for a few years, sort of, and you woke up, and what did you find? So tell people about your Rip Van Winkle story.
Yeah, I start off the book that I talk about this story, my Rip Van Winkle story. And what it is I was a social worker, trained in the 90s, worked over the years, worked with lots of teens and families, schools, hospitals. I was actually at a UCSF job, and then I had to leave that job because of a repetitive stress injury. I had a nerve injury from a poor desk. And it got really bad, and I was out of work for several years. So from the years 2017 to 2021, I was out. I got back to work in 2021, only part-time, because I still have some lingering pain, and I can't work a regular full schedule. And when I got back there, everything was so radically different. And in particular, it was the gender stuff. It wasn't the only thing that was different, but that was the biggest, most glaring thing that I saw. That in this, I lived in the Bay Area of California in San Mateo, and that's where the clinic was. And half the girls were identifying as trans, and none of my colleagues were saying or doing anything. They were encouraging it. And the program trained me, and I didn't do this, but they trained me to prompt the kids to introduce themselves with their names and their pronouns in the teen unit, but not the adult unit. It didn't matter with the adults for some reason. So just the fact that there was just no insight on the fact that these kids were struggling and had other issues and were using this trans thing as a cover up for other things was just dumbfounding to me. So that was my Rip Van Winkle.
So the difference between in 2017, you weren't seeing trans patients. You weren't seeing any of this kind of stuff in 2017.
Not at all. It was barely a thing. I mean, I think it was in the gender clinics in specialized places, but in the general population, like in the just general clinics, it wasn't a thing at all. The last time I in 2017, I was actually working with adults, but I still, had a pulse on what was going on with teens. Certainly wasn't as widespread. The last teen job I had was actually just the year before in 2016, which was at a high school in Palo Alto, California, which is maybe one of the most liberal towns in the entire country, right by Stanford University. There was one trans kid in that entire school, and that's it. So.
So this is a good time for you to also to let people know just a little bit about your training and your experience, because when you read this book, I want you to understand that it's written by somebody who knows what she's talking about. She knows the profession, she knows mental health care, she knows a lot of things. So just give people a little bit more information about your background so they can be confident when they pick up your book.
Yeah, so I was licensed in California in 2005. I actually graduated from grad school back in the late 90s and worked in all kinds of settings, really came up the ranks as a social worker, but then really got into the mental health field. And then I moved up to become a clinical supervisor. And I was a clinical supervisor for 10 years. And what that means to be a clinical supervisor is it was my job to help upcoming therapists work with me and follow their cases and make sure that they're doing the right thing. I help them in situations of crisis. I help them process their cases. I was really in charge of hundreds of cases, and most of those were school-based counselors. And then I also worked in clinics with, like I was just describing, and the latest one, which was with severely mentally ill kids, kids that had just been in the hospital for a suicide attempt or some kind of psychological issue that had a concern for safety. And I've worked in group homes where there was a locked facility, and I even had to do sometimes had to do restraints because the behaviors were so extreme. So I've worked with a lot of, I'd say, difficult teens, but and families. So I think my big emphasis in the book, and then even what we've talked about before, is I was a family therapist. I am a family therapist, and I believe strongly in strengthening the family and strengthening the bonds between a kid and its family, and that's what will help them heal and do better.
Right. And that's one of the things that the whole gender ideology has disrupted in a pretty radical way. I
Exactly.
also want to just pause and notice, because not everybody may be familiar with this, and that is that you're a licensed clinical social worker. And in California, if I'm not mistaken, probably some other places as well, that's one of the credentials that allows you to be a professional therapist. Is that right?
Yeah, you have to have that license, and I think they might be lowering the standards now, but for when I was coming up the ranks, it's quite a rigorous process. It involves several years of clinical practice, two pretty difficult tests, and lots of background experience. And you need that license to be able to get reimbursed by insurance. A lot of the jobs that I had, you need to have the license because for Medi-Cal, it's like the California version of Medicaid, to reimburse, you need to have the license. So yeah, if you're looking for a therapist, that is one of the degrees that you would find is a licensed clinical social worker.
Correct, correct. And you do not have the authority to prescribe medication. That
No.
would not be part of your. Okay, so you if a child or a patient needed medication, you'd be working in tandem with an MD of some sort.
Yeah, I've worked in settings where I worked in tandem with MDs, the way you just described, but I wasn't doing the prescriptions. Sometimes I would
Right.
talk to the doctor and, collaboratively and say, oh, the patient is showing these behaviors or that behaviors, or this is improving, this isn't. But I wasn't making the prescriptions. I can't do that.
Right. So just so everybody has a clear picture of what you know, of your area of expertise and the dynamics of people's interactions is something that you have a lot of skill and talent and expertise in. That would be the main focus, it sounds like, from what you're saying. So now with all that in mind, the chapter I want to start with is your chapter, I think it's number three, Why Are Kids Doing This? Okay. Just give our viewers some insight as to the range of possible reasons that kids might have for saying, Mom, I think I'm a boy, or whatever it is. You got the floor, girlfriend. You take
Yeah,
it.
that's probably, I think it might be the longest chapter, and it kept growing because I kept thinking of more things. Like every time you think of something, there's more things. And I even start out the chapter saying, even though it's a list of 25 or more ideas of why this could be happening, I started off the chapter by saying this isn't even a comprehensive list because there's so many different scenarios here. But yeah, I go into well, to name a few. I mean, the first one that's really big is sexual trauma, so, some kind of sexual assault. When someone has trauma, they often learn to hate their body or they dissociate from their bodies, and or they grow to not like their sexual or, parts. And so it is very enticing to want to become transgender, to kind of reject those parts of you that really have caused you pain or, you believe has caused you pain. Really, it's the trauma. But people who have trauma tend to dissociate from their bodies. They tend to have a lot of self-loathing. And so that this is an easy out for a lot of people who have some kind of sexual trauma. So that's one of the, I say, main reasons.
And you know, our friend Chloe Cole told us exactly that somebody had, pressed her breasts, and she's like, wow, I could get rid of these. That'd be great, type of thing. Walt Heyer reports something
Well,
similar. So our followers who follow this podcast have heard already some of these type of stories that young people share. Tell us some others.
yeah, I even quote both of them in the book. I talk about, yeah, both of them are mentioned, and like Walt has written, as you know, several books where he quotes lots of people because people like to say he's just an exception or something. We know he's not. There's a lot of them out there that have the si similar experiences. So what are some other ones? Well, I mean, first of all, the book talks a lot about just all of the external influences that are out there. The trans activists like to pretend this is sort of natural or this is organic when I just don't understand how anyone with common sense can believe that when we see this all over the place in the media. We see it all, on Netflix when you turn on like a kid show. It's on the commercials. It's like stickers and it's almost all. Every TV show now, a kid show, has some kind of trans theme in it. A Cocomelon, which is a really popular little kid show, now has a little scene with the two dads telling a boy he can be whatever he wants. So there's messages are just being pounded. It's interesting. Now that I just produced this book, I'm looking at Amazon and what the other books are and like the LGBTQ themes are, and I didn't even realize just how many books there are. I thought I did it, but it's really vast how many there are. There's so many books that influence people. So just all that external influence. And then yeah, the internet is the biggest place. What else? So yeah, po politics. There's so many incentives. If you think about how many incentives people have to become trans, I mean, both like socially, you get kind of social credit. A lot of people say that they felt really invisible when they weren't trans, and then they became trans, and then they were noticed. So that's, that's really enticing for someone who really struggles socially, or has some reason to feel invisible. I have show a picture in the book of the White House last June during Pride Month had, I mean, I think it was actually against the code that they had the Pride flag in
Right.
between the two American flags on the front of the White House. So if that's not a message that this is something that, is celebrated and something that, is gives you a reward, I don't know what else is. So it's, and people like to pretend it's natural. I just don't understand that.
So some of the other things you mentioned, though, so the influences are immense, as you've mentioned. And I don't know if you know this. I interviewed a guy called John Bursch, who was one of the attorneys with Alliance Defending Freedom. He actually defended the state of Michigan for its marriage statutes back in 2015. He argued the Obergefell case
Okay.
on the man-woman marriage side in front of the Supreme Court. So he's very tuned in to the whole gay marriage issue, right? And he told me, Pam, that literally within weeks after that court case coming down, trans propaganda was everywhere. I mean, and like Bruce Jenner was on the cover of Vanity Fair the
Right.
same weekend,
Yeah. It's
it
like a
just it's
switch
just
went off,
immense.
right? Yeah.
Yes, that's
They
right.
needed to
Yeah, that's
change
right.
their they needed to change their lobbying and, get everybody on board with
But they
this
were
new
ready.
rights. Yeah, this new
They
human
were ready
rights
for it.
issue. Yeah. So I know it seems coordinated, doesn't it?
But let's go back to the kids themselves. So I think everybody understands there's all these influences, and they could unduly influence somebody who's vulnerable in some other ways.
Yes.
So tell people a little bit about some of the vulnerabilities that you see among the young people who do get swayed by this stuff.
Yeah, so what how I view the whole trans thing is what it is it's preying on the vulnerable. So there is some kind of vulnerability, and the trans activists and the trans community, they kind of prey on that. So one of the biggest vulnerabilities is people who are autistic or have autistic traits. So someone who has more rigid thinking, someone who struggles socially, someone maybe who spends more time online as a kind of a gamer. These are ways to, grab a kid, and if they don't, have kind of a good social network outside of that, it's much easier for them to get indoctrinated, to get, convinced that they're born in the wrong body. And then, of course, they have the temperament that once they start are convinced of an idea, it's harder to change their minds because that's just sort of their temperament. They have more rigid thinking. So I think the trans activists know this. So they're literally marketed to. They have a trans flag. There's a flag that has this infinity symbol on it and a rainbow to I'd say to draw in the autistic kids. And there's products like headphones and things that have autistic symbols on them and pride symbols on them. There's all kinds of stuff online and accounts directly marketed to them. And then yeah, the flags, all the flags. Autistic people tend to like flags, it's like a place, it's something to belong to. And so it's just that's one of the biggest ones. I'd just say when there's issues in the family, so that's a lot of what I talk about in the book for parents to take notice of. If you're having a vulnerability in your family, like, and I'm not even saying that you are doing something wrong as a parent. I'm just saying when, unfortunately, families go through things like perhaps illness or perhaps a move or perhaps a divorce. And the trans activists know this, that the families are going through a vulnerable time, and they swoop in and they snatch the kids when the kids are maybe not getting as much attention as they would normally when the family's not in crisis. So these are things for parents to recognize, because oftentimes when I work with families, I'll ask them, when did your child become trans? And usually they'll say, oh, it was when this happened in the family. They'll take note of that. So yeah, so family issues, sometimes it has to do with the dynamics, like perhaps like there's a special needs sibling, and oftentimes it's kind of the good kid, if you however you want to call that, the cooperative kid that doesn't is not a behavioral problem, the kind of more quiet kid that chooses to be trans because they have felt invisible, and this is a way to be seen. So yeah, there's so many different scenarios here. Another one is like when someone has a disability, like the trans community tends to like market to kids with disabilities, because once again, they are not able to do regular activities. Maybe they have less friends because they're, have more restrictions, and they don't feel at home in their bodies. So anybody who doesn't feel at home in their body, it's easier to convince them that they were born in the wrong body. And yeah, and these are just teens that are struggling anyway. And then add these other factors in, it just makes it even harder. And then all the influences.
And so you used a phrase that I want to pause on for a moment, because if a trans activist were to watch this and pick up on what you said, they might jump on you. So I want to give you a chance to explain what you meant. You talk about that. I think you said the trans activists know this and they swoop in and they take the kid. I want you to be specific
Okay.
As specific as you can about what you mean by that. Are you speaking metaphorically? Are you speaking literally? Tell us more precisely what you're referring to there.
Well, I think they are looking for kids that are vulnerable, and they tell the what I call love bombing. I'm not the only one that calls it that. They kind of love bomb the kid, a kid that's struggling, and they tell that child that they're loved and they're safe and this is their safe place, and that they can be their authentic self. They can do whatever, however they feel, and they'll be accepted. And so there's so many, it's like sometimes it's direct, where an actual predator online can actually f they know how to look out for kids. I talk about this, online predators. There's a website called the Trevor Project, which they say that they're about suicide prevention and helping kids, but they have these chat rooms that have predators inside of them that I have seen actually recruit kids, or talk to them in inappropriate ways, because they have from age like 12 to 25, so they have young age up to adult ages. So yeah, and then a lot of it also is just subtle. So then they just have like memes or messaging that's just like, you are loved, and just like influencers that grab the attention of someone that's feeling alone. So it's not really direct. It's not an individual actually taking, pointing at a kid and saying, I want you, or something like that. But it's more like the marketing, the messaging that the kids are getting. And then they're told that the people who question the trans identity, who know that they are born as a boy or a girl, that those people are become their enemy. So that's why I see them as predators, because they're teaching kids that the people that love them are against them, and they're turning the people that love them against them. And that's what predators do.
And that's an extremely important point. We were all taught to help kids stay safe, don't take candy from strangers, that type of thing. But this is a whole different layer of predatory behavior that kids need to be astute to, and that parents need to be tuned into. And I think your book is helpful in that way of helping people zoom in on that or identify that. Let's take a look at this now in a sense from the child's perspective, which is. Let's say somebody's watching this and they have a child, and the child says, "Mom, I think I'm trans." Okay. Talk with people about some of the things the child might actually be saying, and how do you get them to say what's really going on, as opposed to just sticking with this, putting the label on themselves, and then that's the end of the conversation. Talk to people about that, Pam.
Yeah, I think when a kid is telling a parent that they're trans, they're telling them that they're struggling with something. And it's your job as a parent and as an adult, and maybe even the other people around, to figure out what that is that they're struggling with. So there's some kind of underlying issue. It could be a deeper thing, or it could be more, on the surface, like something's just happening in the moment with the family. But I think it's a way that kids are saying, I need you to notice me. I need you to look at me. I need you to pay attention to some kind of hurt or pain that I'm having. And I need you to figure that out. And I'm probably going to be really oppositional when you question the trans thing, but underneath that, I'm also looking for you to ground me in, the truth.
The problem with a child in this kind of situation is that they are going to give you some opposition,
Yeah.
and the challenge for the parent is to figure out how to maintain their composure through that opposition and hang on to the truth so that they can continue to be present for them. What are some of the traumas that the kids might be trying to reveal to the parent?
Well, I mean, like kind of like what I said before, it could be something going on with them as an individual, or it could be something going on within the family, or it could, the it is kind of broad. But yeah, I was about to say, kind of to like when that you get that opposition, the struggle is how do you handle that, still showing love without getting angry and pushing your kid further away and into the hands of people that are going to convince your child that you don't love your child. Because I the this book is written for families that love their children. So yeah, there's so many scenarios. I like other mental health issues are, there's always some comorbid health ish mental health issue. So it could be depression, it could be anxiety, it could be bullying at school, it could be an eating disorder. They actually market to kids with eating disorders. They say, like, if you don't, if yeah,
Oh.
yeah, they, and those. I mean, if they say if you feel uncomfortable in your clothes, then you could be trans, or you could have dysphoria. If you don't like the sound of your voice, you could have dysphoria. So if you have any kind of self-loathing, if you're depressed and you're just looking, you're a teenager, like picking yourself apart, or let's just say you're a teenager who's been locked down for 2 years and has been forced to cover your face, and then now you're in the world and you think you're ugly and you think you're gross, which is a kind of a common feeling for especially adolescent girls. And you've got this group of people that says you will feel good inside your skin if you just change the whole thing. And this magic, this whole thing will make all that ugly feeling go away. So anytime someone's having some kind of mental health issue or just self-loathing, the trans stuff is quite attractive.
I've been struck by how often the trans, the detransitioners, the desisters, when they recount their stories, they're often talking about, they will often talk about the comorbidities, the other mental health problems that they had that nobody ever helped them address, right? That everybody went immediately to the gender thing and all the other stuff was kind of off the table. Is there something in that? In that process, is there a way that parents can be a little bit more proactive in getting the mental health conversation back to where it belongs?
I mean,
You know, away
proactive
from the gender stuff.
before they even sort of get latched onto this idea.
Well, hopefully for sure, hopefully yes, but if you are distracted by the trans stuff, how do people get it back onto the to the real issue, the depression or the anxiety or whatever the other issues might be.
I mean, the truth is, it's not easy. And that's kind of what I say in my book. Like, I do give a lot of ideas and prompts, but I can't offer a script because a lot of it has to do with your child, your relationship with your child, and how you can start a conversation with them, how deep they are in the idea, because if they kind of just if it's sort of new to them and they just come home with it quickly and say they have this, you can maybe say something really frank with them, like, hey, like this, you just can't be a boy, right? You can be really frank and direct with them. Or if they've spent several months kind of secretly exploring this and been in deep with it for a long time, a lot of times it happens even for over a year or more where they're doing this secretly because the schools keep secrets and they're mingling with people, their peers that are doing this or other social groups. And so then it's harder to break them out of it when they've been in this kind of echo chamber that this is the right way to be. And if you're not, you're a bigot, you're a transphobe. So it really depends a lot on like how deep they are in it and then your relationship with your child. But what I really encourage is, yeah, to open up a conversation, just asking them more open-ended questions about, why they feel uncomfortable, maybe how they came to this conclusion, like maybe in a way that's more curious and less confrontational or less even trying to convince them out of it, starting out more from a curious point of view so that they feel heard and listened to. Because really, this is about them wanting to be seen. So you can still show them that you see them without affirming this, this trans identity. So that's sort of the goal. And a lot of this does happen. It happened during the lockdowns because kids were on screens and families were just in crisis because there was so much going on in terms of businesses being lost and, families struggling. So kids were left to their own devices. So a lot of this has to do with being present for your kids. So if you're more present with your kids, that I think that will go a long way in pulling them out of it. Because when they're left more to their own devices, which happens a lot to these kids, they're in the room, they're on their phone, or they're, with their friends who are on their phones, and they get more sucked in and they're not brought back to reality. But if you're having more family time, if you're helping them be more in real life, things like that, those things go a long way.
Now, there are a couple of myths that we hear. I think they're myths, and I want you to help people break them down. Pamela, in your opinion, is it possible for somebody to be born in the wrong body?
So yeah, the first chapter of the book is anyone born in the wrong body? And I actually don't say outright the answer to that. What I do is I explain how there is no proof of that and how there is a lot of proof, a lot of things that show that perhaps that is more of a belief system, kind of almost like a religion, a new religion, to have this sort of gendered soul inside of a body. I just want to disclose that I actually used to believe that there were a select very few people that maybe were born in the wrong body, or let's just say maybe would do better if they got surgeries and hormones and were treated as the opposite sex. I used to believe that. But actually getting to know some of the people and kind of observing them too, and I write about this, is there are some clues that show that they actually still are struggling. It might feel good like it's sort of like a cover up for it's not really resolving their issues. There's something underneath that they haven't resolved. There's a very popular YouTuber who's called Blair White, who I honestly like, who's a man who is very in truth and presents as a woman. And just recently, Blair just admitted on a podcast, Blair said, I know this isn't politically correct, but I am transgender because of sexual assault, a sexual trauma. And Blair admitted
Wow.
that, even though Blair will say, I'm true trans or that, all of that. So Blair just admitted that. It'll be interesting to watch, if that transgresses into, maybe changing, perspectives. I don't know. But the point is, that's somebody who's been held up as the example of like, well, there are certain people that this is
Right.
right for. But every time I get to know the person, either in person or, they start being more honest, I realize that actually there's always something underneath it, and they're really not feeling that satisfied. They're still struggling. So it's you know, so I'll just say the short answer, no. No, it's born in the wrong body.
It's physical. It's physical nonsense. It's metaphysical nonsense. I mean, you are your body. You're every person is a composite of body and soul. You know, that's the most reasonable position to hold, I think, that makes sense of our interior life, but also makes sense of the fact that we're embodied. This is who you
This
are,
is
the
your
body.
body, whether you like it
This
or
is it.
not. Yeah.
This is who we are, you know. And for my Catholic catechism, you know, we had a question back in the day in the Baltimore Catechism: what is man? And man means man and woman, generic man. What is man? Man is a creature, not God. Man is a creature composed of body and soul, made in the image and likeness of God. And so that little definition kind of keeps a lot of boogeymen away, you know. I mean, it inoculates you against certain kinds of thought processes, which, as you've shown, are very seductive. These are seductive thought processes. It looks like it's a solution to a problem, but it isn't really, you know, and it causes a whole range of other problems, some of which you talk about in the book. Now, I think before we go further, because I'm going to want to talk with you about the suicide issue, I want to talk with you about, I want you to help us play out some role playing for how parents can talk with their kids. But before we do that, we're going to take our little break and encourage all of our followers to go over to the Locals channel. You may notice, Ruthie's, that she mentioned the Trevor Project. If you follow the Ruth Institute at all, you know that the Trevor Project often puts little warning labels on our videos. So we like to go over to Locals where we're treated like grown-up people who can make up their own mind and think for themselves. Okay, see you in a minute, everybody.